is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like a sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing. Slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
You reign forever, our hope. seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we'll step into the valley unafraid. As we call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. God of endless mercy, God of unrelenting love, rescue every door to bring us back the wayward sons. By your Spirit breathe upon, show the world that you alone can save. You alone can save.
I am free. child of God. Yes, I am.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus.
I said at the beginning, it's an absolute pleasure to welcome Jonty Forster this evening. Jonty is curate at St. Gabriel's in Highton. So it's great to have you here this evening with us, Jonty, to talk about being rooted in hope. So, Jonty, if we just pray for you before I hand over to you to speak. So let's pray together. Thanks, Father, we just pray that you will speak through Jonty's words that he has to share with us this evening. I pray, Lord, that we will have ears that are open to hear from you, Lord, and that we will just be able to receive what it is from you that you want us to receive tonight. So, Lord, I do just pray that you will use Jonty as your mouthpiece this evening as he speaks to us now. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, amen. Jonty, welcome, and over to you.
Thanks, mate. Well, hi everyone. It's great to be with you this evening, and thanks for asking me to come and speak to you all on the topic of hope. Now, before we get into it, obviously Gareth just introduced me. I'm Jonty. I'm a curate in Highton at a church called St Gabriel's, and before that, I was a commissioning manager in the NHS for about 12 years. I'm married to Sarah. And we've got two children who we absolutely love homeschooling at the moment, which is just like the best thing in the world. I'm not lying at all. Looking forward to the first day of term tomorrow. And other than that, really, I'm a big football fan, but I'm not a red and I'm not a blue. So you're not going to get any sass off me tonight. I'm a Latic because I lived in Wigan for 5 years when I was a teenager, and I fell in love with Wigan Athletic. So there we go. That's pretty much me in a nutshell. But talking about the theme of hope, you know, I haven't got many illustrations on hope from my time following Wigan, given their recent history. So I'm much more qualified to talk about despair, really. But most of tonight's illustrations, and this is a new area of illustration, but most of tonight's illustrations are based in nature, which is something I've learned to appreciate a lot more over the last 12 months. But I am just a novice. And I've only just really started taking notice of nature. But yeah, I wanted to begin by talking to you about an image of hope. An image of hope that's been with me for a few years, really. A few years ago, I was forced to go on a silent retreat by my theological college. And I say forced. We just had a family bereavement, and I just didn't want to go. I just couldn't be bothered. And someone in the kind of pastoral team suggested might be a good idea, actually, if you just go, might be good for you. And in fairness, it really was. It to be a really good experience. It was at a place called St Bino's in North Wales. I think it's St Bino's, but it's written like Bueno, so it's like Kinder Bueno. But it's a good place to go anyway, so it works like that. And it's absolutely beautiful, this place. And anyway, one day I went for this. I went for a prayer walk because there was nothing else to do. Because it was a silent retreat, and someone said, "Go to this place here. It's really beautiful." Although they shouldn't have told me, because it was a silent retreat, as I've said. But I went for this walk to this beauty spot, and as I was walking, I was thinking and I was praying, and I got to this like spot where they said to go to, and I looked into the valley, and there was just like a river and a load of trees. And all the trees were like bare. And I thought, this is horrible. This isn't beautiful. This is horrible. Like, everything looks dead. And I genuinely, in that moment, I genuinely felt God say to me, just wait. Just wait. And obviously, I didn't wait 3 months for the season to change. But the point was that it got me thinking that the tree that is rooted will always blossom in the spring, regardless of the harshness of the winter. You know, for the tree, hope and life come from being rooted in the ground and being close to water. And for Christians, our hope comes from being rooted and grounded in Christ, as Paul puts it in Colossians. So the passage I want to focus on tonight, it's not Colossians, by the way, as we think about hope. It's something from Isaiah chapter 40, which... some of the words are actually woven into one of the songs that we've just sung, actually. But it's from the end of Isaiah 40, verses 28 to 31, and it says this. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary, and they will walk and not be faint. And in the lead up to these verses, the prophet Isaiah, he's rebuking the people of God and their feelings of abandonment over the exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. And Isaiah is basically having a go at them for having their heads turned by the Babylonians during exile, and they've been impressed by the empire, and they've kind of started comparing the Babylon way to God's way. And then the verses kind of go back, probably going back to about verse 12, and Isaiah saying, there is no comparison. These Babylonian things have got nothing on God. Yet the people have had their heads turned by the impressiveness of the empire, by the size of their idols, by the heritage of their royalty, by their knowledge of all things, in particular, the kind of celestial bodies in the sky. And so Isaiah tells them that this is all so unimpressive compared to God, because God writes the history of the empires, and God doesn't wobble or rust like an idol. God raises up and brings down the rulers, and God controls the celestial bodies. And then this is what brings us up to this amazing encouragement of Isaiah 40, verses 28 to 31. And he's telling the people of God, it's foolish to be impressed by Babylon. Yeah, it's been a difficult and a dark time in exile, but you have never left God's sight, and you have never left God's concern. God is everlasting. God is about to act. God is about to restore. Don't put your hope in the other things, but stay rooted in God. You know who God is and what God's done and what God will do. So put your hope in God. And if you do, you won't grow faint or weary. You'll be strengthened and sustained. So where do we fit into all this? Where do we fit into all this? Well, after the past 12 dark and difficult months, I think we could be forgiven for feeling like the people of God in this verse, you know, fearful, abandoned, and looking to anything for hope. But the verse from Isaiah is a great reminder to us of God's faithfulness, and that with God, nothing is hopeless. And kind of as this pandemic has escalated again and life's gone into lockdown again, things have got harder. I'm sure people we know have passed away. This verse has kept me focused on God. It's kept me focused on hope, rather than being focused on fear and focused on other things. But it's also highlighted to me how easy it is to root our hope in other things in order to keep us going. Now, as I said, I'm not much of a naturalist, I'm not much of a bird watcher, but apparently when it rains, most birds kind of duck for cover and they kind of head for shelter. But the eagle that we've sung about, and the eagle that was in our passage, the eagle will soar above the clouds, thus avoiding the storm. I read that a few weeks ago. I'm hoping it's true, but I thought it was a nice image. You know, most things duck and cover, but the eagle soars above the clouds. Now, I'm a big lover of cinema. I'm a big lover of sport. I love going out to eat. I love going out to drink. And not being able to do any of those things this year has highlighted to me how much I rely on these activities to cheer me up. Now, there's nothing wrong with that in essence, is there? But this year has highlighted to me that often when the storms or the droughts have come, they were my go-to comforts rather than God. They were the things that I went to first to kind of cheer myself up. And now they're not bad things, essentially they're good things, but I guess what I'm saying is that they shouldn't be the first things. And that's because their experiences or securities, they don't last, essentially. And when they've not been there this year, I've realized how much I was hiding behind them instead of looking to God. I'd been ducking for cover, if you like, when trouble came, rather than soaring like the eagle above the storm to rest in the hope that lies above. So I guess a question for us tonight is, you know, what are the things that keep us going at the moment? Where might we be ducking for cover? Where might we be rooting our hope? It could be a vaccine, could be a family gathering, it could be a hug from a loved one, it could be a holiday, could be a pint in the pub, could be a trip to the cinema, could be going to the match, could be food in your favorite restaurant, an employment opportunity, financial aid, physical respite. It could be any of those things, it could be something completely different. But what Isaiah 40, 28 to 31 reminds us is that we don't find our hope in these things. They are all good and they are all necessary. But other than momentary kind of enjoyment or security, they can't really offer us anything more. But what the wider story of Scripture tells us is that in Jesus, God has given us the only lasting fulfillment of hope. In Jesus, we have a lasting fulfillment of hope. But what is this hope that Jesus gives us? Well, the hope that Jesus gives us, it's more than escapism, and it's more than security. The hope that Jesus gives us is resurrection hope. Now, I've just finished reading this book by Graham Tomlin. I don't know if you can see that there. I think it's called Why Being Yourself is a Bad Idea, but half it's crossed out, so it might just be called Being Yourself, but it's really good. I'd highly recommend it. It's only it's a smallish book. It's really good. Highly recommend it. And in it, there's a description of the hope of resurrection, which I found really helpful. And so I thought I'd share it this evening as we've come together. And in it, Graham Tomlin's basically saying that when the resurrection of Jesus happened, something changed in history and a new world was born. And he compares it to the winter solstice. So every year in the UK, autumn approaches and the dark nights kind of draw in. And the daytime gets shorter until on December the 21st, something undetectable shifts. And the earth tilts. And the days suddenly start getting longer as spring approaches. But it doesn't immediately feel any different. In fact, December the 22nd and December the 23rd feel much the same as December the 21st. You know, it's cold, it's wet, it's dark. Yet something really has changed. Something really has changed. And likewise, following Jesus's defeat of death on the cross, the world can still feel full of darkness. But because of a weekend in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, something in the world has dramatically shifted. And so though we continue to experience the dark days of winter, there is hope because spring is coming. And though we continue to experience darkness and death and destruction in the world, there is hope because a time is coming where there'll be no more death and no more mourning, no more crying and no more pain, when the new creation will bring restoration. And if this, I guess this kind of feels doubly poignant as we sit here on a dark February evening. We went out to Calderstones Park this afternoon, and there was signs of spring just jumping out all over the place. There was crocuses, there was snowdrops, all these kind of the flowers, the first signs of spring. And it kind of reminded me of the Chronicles of Narnia, and where it's always winter and it's never Christmas until Aslan breaks this curse. And the signs of the snow melts and signs of spring start to pop up everywhere. And then the inhabitants of Narnia are all whispering that Aslan is on the move. And in the same way, you know, Jesus is a roaring lion. He's the Lion of Judah, and he's broken a curse of sin and death on the cross. And, you know, in his resurrection and his ascension and Pentecost, he's been moving and working by the power of the Holy Spirit to breathe hope into our lives through transformation and restoration. There's another book I'm going to share with you now. This is another book by Pete Hughes, and it's called All Things New. And there's in it, he says this. He says, though we experience loss and we taste grief, we don't lose hope, because though Jesus died, he rose again, which means nothing is beyond his redemptive power. And more than that, the power of the risen Christ from the grave is coursing through the veins of his followers, empowering us to live in and live out his glorious story. So through Jesus, the kingdom of God is near. Through Jesus, we can be made new. Through Jesus, we can have the Holy Spirit living in us and working through us. Through Jesus, we're called beloved sons and daughters of God. Through Jesus, we have an eternal place reserved for us when God's kingdom comes on earth in fullness. And this is hope. This is the hope of Jesus, that despite all the tough times, everything is not lost. Jesus is a light in a dark world, calling us onto and guiding us into a better future than we can ask for or imagine. And it's a future in which we're all being transformed and made new. 1 Peter 1, 3 and 4 says that we have been born anew to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled and unfading. Isn't that amazing? That is hope. That is the hope of Jesus. And so obviously the resurrection has always been good news. It's not a new thing that we've just stumbled across. It's always been good news. But I think in this season, when the reality of our mortality is staring us in the face, the hope of resurrection takes on a whole new level. And it's a hope that is rooted in what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do. And essentially, if we want to be rooted in that hope, we need to be rooted in Jesus Christ. If we want to be rooted in that hope, we need to be rooted in Christ. Just like the bare trees I spoke of at the beginning, you know, in the same, in our lives, there'll be harsh seasons. We'll face harsh seasons in our lives. There'll be death of loved ones. There'll be loss of jobs. There'll be unexpected illness. There'll be the destruction of addiction. And even now this year, we know that, you know, facing global pandemics. But what the Bible tells us is that those who are rooted in Christ will overcome. If we're disconnected from Christ, then once a harsh season hits, then our faith can wither. But if we're rooted in Christ, if we're connected to him, if we're abiding in him, if we're remaining in him, then our faith can be sustained in a harsh season, and we'll see blossom and bear fruit again. But in order to do that, we need to fix our eyes on Jesus, on what he has done, on what he is doing, and on what he will do. And we need to focus on how through his life, his death, his resurrection and his ascension, and the sending of his spirit at Pentecost, Jesus is calling us to a new future. And it's a future that is empty of fear, but full of hope. So in this difficult time, when we hope for so much, let us not put our hope in the earthly things that we so love, as good as they are. But let us put our hope in the right thing. Better still, let us put our hope in the right person, Jesus Christ. Let us look to Jesus, God with us. Because those who hope in him, those who are rooted in him, will be renewed in strength and sustained in life. And they will soar on the wings like eagles. And they will run and they will not grow weary. And they will walk and they will not be faint. And so as we respond to that passage this evening, we're going to wait on God for a moment. I'm going to play a song in a minute, but some questions that you might like to have running through your mind as we listen to the song and wait on God are these. You know, if you're feeling tired, if you're feeling tired, ask the Lord to be restored. If you're fed up, if you're feeling fed up, if you're weary, ask the Lord to re-energize you. If you're feeling weak, ask the Lord to empower you. If you're feeling old in yourself, maybe, then ask the Lord for renewal. And if you're feeling hopeless, maybe you could ask the Lord to root you or to reroot you in Christ, in his story of resurrection that calls us onto and guides us into this promised better future. that's all I've got to say tonight, really. But I'm going to play this song. It's called Living Hope, and it speaks about the day when everything changed, the day when everything shifted, when death was defeated, when Jesus claimed the victory, and how we as his friends and followers can stand in that victory with him and have hope in his promise of salvation, transformation, and restoration.
Out of the side.